We're going to listen to a song called Jungle. Will you tell us about the song before we play it?
In a pretty bad headspace when I wrote that song, I was just kind of getting drunk all the time because I was using that as an escape. And I was a bit torn between my head, my heart, that kind of thing. So I just thought, I'll set up my stuff and I'll just have a jam. And that song came out in a night. I literally wrote that song in one night and put it up and it just went...
Yeah. Were you surprised by the reaction to it?
Yeah. I just didn't expect it.
All right. Well, let's listen to the song. Tash, thanks so much for being on The Current.
Thanks.
This is Jungle.
So that early stage was completely crazy. Like I remember lying in bed and refreshing her social media pages, and they were going up like thousands every 5 minutes. Like, I'm not exaggerating. Like the likes and the subscribers and all that sort of stuff. That was just going crazy to the point where I was like, the phone was just constantly vibrating. I had to turn off all the notifications, and that was because we had the viral video. I think now it's at like 55 million or something. I don't even know. And that's one of them. There's another that got to 40. It just was everyone was just sharing and subscribing and liking, and it just got to a point where it was just crazy.
It was incredibly exciting watching the 2016 Jungle Bedroom video go viral. I remember like an endless WhatsApp conversation with Regan, with who I managed Tash together. It was fantastic. It's the most exciting thing that can happen. It's amazingly good.
And I think it all begun, you know, with the incredible videos that Tash has been putting on the internet, and people just sharing it with their friends and going, oh my God, have you seen this artist from Australia? Like, check this out, you know. And that extends to the music, that extends to the live show, and it's just this really viral thing, because you can be in a city where she's sold 5,000 or 6,000 tickets, and a lot of people walking down the street would never have heard of Tash Sultana, but those that know.
So people were approaching Tash and sending her notes and stuff. We had all these inquiries from around the world coming in. There ended up having 21, I think it was a 23 deals on the table, official deals from different labels.
So every label was contacting us, and I mean every label. Like, I was on calls early with America, I was on calls late with the UK, all the labels, and I think we whittled it down to 11, and then from there we whittled it down to 4. Genuine Continues, we talked through all the options and then decided what was right for us, and that was Mum and Pop in North America, Sony for the rest of the world.
Thanks for having us here tonight. On the first of your 3 sold out albums, which is pretty mental. So it's only been 6 months since your album came out, and it's pretty amazing, you know, so that we're at this level. Obviously in that time as well, Mystic has gone gold, Murder to the Mind has gone gold, Notion is now platinum. So we wanted to make some plaques to congratulate you on
There's an amazing member of our marketing team from Sony in Melbourne called Marietta Uzas, and she flicked me an email just saying she'd seen, I think she'd been watching Tash for a while busking, and then saw her play a show and just called me and was like, you've got to come see her. And she was doing the residency in North Coast Social like the next week, so she had 3 shows there, and I went down to Melbourne and was just blown away. That was the first time.
Very early on, from a very early stage, the Sony team, Paul Harris, just kept turning up to shows. I think he went to about 15 Tash shows before we got the deal on the table properly. He was just obsessed.
I think the following week she was playing at the Brighton Up Bar, which is like an 80 cap venue in Sydney. Tiny, sweaty little room. It was her first, I think it was her first Sydney show. And I took, that was when I'd mentioned to Dennis, who's our head guy here, the big boss. And I was like, Dennis, there's this girl, I think we really need to go and see it. So he came along to that show with me, and we were there pinned at the back of the room, sweating away. and it was amazing. I mean, it was awful and amazing. The sound wasn't great, but the energy and the reaction from the audience, like every single person, all 80 of them were in that room hanging on every single word that was coming out of Tash's mouth. So that was the beginning of we've got to work together, we've got to find a way. And that led to a fairly lengthy courtship process. I think I trekked around the world with Tash for about 6 months after that, trying to work out a deal and a way that we could work together and I could, you know, help, or not even help, embellish what she was already doing.
Let's sit down. Let's grab some shit, because I got all these ideas.
The first thing that I ever watched were obviously her YouTube videos. All the videos that she shot just fully in her bedroom, playing a million different instruments that I had no idea how she had self-taught herself everything. And I immediately had that holy shit moment where I said, well, whatever Tash is doing is going to be huge.
Susanna first reached out to management in the summer of 16, and Thaddeus and I drew straws as to who could get to go to Australia to meet with Tash. Thad jumped on a plane and sat down, saw a couple shows in Australia, and sat down with Regan and Tash. And towards the end of, you know, they came back to us shortly thereafter and said, we would like to work with you, meaning mom and pop. And I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that we have a lot of relationships in Australia, and they were able to really get a sense of, you know, how well we you know, hopefully stand behind our words and our commitments. So it got negotiated fairly quickly in December of
2016,
and that's sort of when it got completed, and then I think she came over a couple months later.
Yep.
I wanted to very early set things up. I didn't want Tash to be like a flash in the pan, have a viral video and then disappear. I really wanted to set things up as a career artist and have a 10 to 15 to 20 year career. And building everything around live was the foundation of that, and keeping things global, not having just an artist that goes around Australia. A lot of people were doing that at the time. So it was very important, even in the early days, to get her overseas.
We'd basically already locked in an agent in the UK through Paul Boswell at Free Trade Agency. So by the time Jungle was about to be released, Tash had an agent, and we'd organized and planned a trip to Europe, like an introductory trip to Europe.
I've never experienced interest any wider. From the smallest markets to the smallest villages and towns, the interest just sort of flows in.
Hello, tell me about this Tash Sultana.
I think the first European trip was 3 or 4 months after the video broke, and we just did little clubs, but it all sold out, and that really set things up. Paul Boswell did an incredible job in UK, and Dave Toothius. And
the great thing about nowadays is that we're 2 clicks away, like data can confirm whether you're right or wrong, and you can actually go where the public actually is, where your fans actually are, instead of where you think they are. She is amazing, so it follows perfectly that the word of mouth will be amazing.
It's really strange when you like go to the other side of the world and then like all these people rock up because you're playing your show. Thank you.
Got 700 cap. I mean, tiny compared to what we're doing now, but that was only 18 months ago. The crew at that point was myself. I was tour managing, doing front of house, Tash's dad, Anthony. And then Regan came on the road and helped out with just general stuff. And yeah, that was the crew.
So there's 5 of us in a like Ford cargo van, basically traveling across the States. So doing everything from driving to picking up food to helping check into hotels or whatever needed to be done.
One of the most recent tours we've done, we've had a crew of maybe 20 people, 22 people, I think. It's gone from, you know, going around in a van to 2 buses and 2 trucks. It's pretty big.
It was kind of a perfect storm. I mean, she came here and she played, you know, Mercury Lounge and Rough Trade. And, you know, those are rooms that are in between, you know, like, what are they, like 250, 300,
yeah, about 300
rooms,
yeah,
stuff like, yeah, that.
And she, 400.
Jackie and I saw Tash the second show, which was at the Mercury Lounge in New York. Tash is real. Like, it's that you're getting, what you see is what you get. I don't even think that Tash cares necessarily whether
agree
like her music or her art.
Yeah, and Tash makes the music that she needs to make, and it's by happenstance that so many thousands and hundreds of thousands of people need to hear it as well.
We just continued to return and build Canada and Mexico and the Latin American countries. And yeah, we just, everywhere Tash went, we just saw the audiences just getting bigger and bigger. And like I was mentioning before, it's not just New York and LA, it's, you know, Charleston, South Carolina, and it's Sao Paulo, Brazil. You know, people turning up in the thousands and supporting and listening and singing along to this music. It's incredible.